All right. Good morning. Good to see everybody here today. Thanks for joining us. If you're here in person, let me invite you to take out your smartphone and you can open the camera app, scan the Staten Island picture there. And on that, it'll bring up a website. And on the website, you can connect with Bethel. You can check in on Facebook. You can submit a prayer request. And you can give to Bethel. Well, that is through our online giving app. And you can give to Bethel either through a general fund. And let me also encourage you today to give to our deacon fund. Our deacon fund is used to help the people within the church that have some special financial needs. We want to help those people. But the church has voted to allow a matching fund to help Ukraine. And so if you give to the deacon fund, it will be matched up to $2,000. And as of Thursday, I think we still had $750 that was available to be part of that matching fund. So you can give online to do that. If you would prefer to give by check, there are some Deacon Fund envelopes in the back by the giving box, and you can put your money in that and drop it in the giving box. And whatever is given to the Deacon Fund today will be matched. Again, I think there's $750 or so that is available to be matched so that we can give to Samaritan's Purse and to the EFCA. Samaritan's Purse set up a field hospital in Ukraine, and they are doing a lot of humanitarian aid that way. We are part of the EFCA, the Evangelical Free Church of America, and they have a group of pastors and missionaries that are part of the missionary arm, which is Reach Global. And so 90% of whatever we give will go to Samaritan's Purse and helping with that field hospital, and then 10% will go to the EFCA's missionaries and pastors who are serving there in Ukraine and the surrounding areas, Poland and different nations there. So there again, both those organizations are helping with humanitarian aid in the name of Christ. We want to be a blessing to them so that they can continue to serve Christ there. And whatever you give today will be matched, again, up to $750 total available. This morning we also have the great benefit of starting our children's Sunday school. We've been kind of teasing it with some videos in the service. This morning we actually start that. That will take place right after service. So if you're a child and want to join us right at the stairs, top of the stairs, Miss Kim will be available to take you downstairs, and we'll be meeting in the purple classroom. Parents are welcome to just stay around, hang out in the lobby, and we'll bring your kids up after that children's Sunday school this morning. But to teeth, what's that? So it'll be about 30 minutes or so is what we're going to start with for our children's Sunday school. So is our preparation for that, we do have one video to show to kind of as a teaser for that children's Sunday school.
Whoa, slow down. You're going to break the speed of sound.
Me and Grandpa are off to the farmer's market. We have to get there early if we want to get the big sales.
Big sales. All right, Mr. Wall Street. Is Lucy coming with you?
Lucy, Lucy, Lucy. Don't say that name.
Did you have a fight?
No, she's just always around. But not today. It's just me and Grandpa, Grandpa and me. Absolutely no Lucy.
Hey, AJ.
Sorry I'm late, Grandpa. What's Lucy doing here?
I invited her. The more the merrier, right?
Here you go, Mr. Jack.
Thank you, kiddo. You're the best. See, the more the merrier. Okay. I think we're ready. Now all we need is some customers.
Oh, I can get their attention, Grandpa.
Oh, want some help?
No, I can do it. Get your tomatoes. Get your ripe tomatoes.
Hello, mate. You want tomato?
Get your tomatoes. Get your ripe tomatoes.
Hello, mate. You want tomato?
A tomato? Anyone? Please! Please, I want my tomatoes. I don't think anyone wants tomatoes.
Who wants a tomato for a dollar each?
I'll take one.
I'll take two.
I'll take three.
Thank
Have
you.
Have a nice day. I just sold a bunch, Mr. Jack.
Good job, kiddo. That's great.
That does it.
AJ.
All right. So what's going to happen between AJ and Lucy? And what is going to be our story today? This month, the emphasis is on the parables of Jesus, and so that will be the lesson this morning. As we open up our service this morning, let us pray, inviting God to be here with us. Father, we are so thankful that you are here with us, that you have come, that you are with your people. We thank you that we can worship and celebrate your presence here with us. We thank you that you have called us as brothers and sisters in Christ to come together in unity, and that we, together with one voice, will lift up our praises to you. We thank you for your word that teaches us, that instructs us in how to live this life. In all things, we want to bring honor and glory to you, and we pray that would happen even this morning. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand as we sing and worship?
Good morning. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness and the privilege of living in this country, USA, where we can worship with our prayers, our songs, our tithes, and hearing from your word in peace and safety. Amen. Welcome. We are happy that you're with us today, that you can join us either here in person or via Facebook. A little redundant, but I'm giving the same announcements as the pastor, but it'll be easy to remember. There will be a children's Sunday school after service downstairs in the fellowship hall. The subject for March is the parable of Jesus. There is a prayer meeting before service at 9:30 in the nursery. Anyone interested in being baptized can please reply by the virtual bulletin or contact the pastor elders, or I guess you can use the phone on the what you would call it in the back of the pews. The small group study is held on Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. downstairs in the fellowship hall. If you want to contribute to the Ukraine Deacon Fund, the Deacon Fund still has matching funds available. There are offering envelopes in the back of the church by the giving box. The bulk of the funds collected will go to Samaritan's Purse. They have a presence in Ukraine through the Operation Christmas Child and have teams on the ground in Poland, Moldova, and Romania, and is setting up a field hospital in the Ukraine. They have sent a DC-8 cargo jet and will send a 747 cargo jet filled with supplies to the area. Lastly, next Saturday, March 26th, starting at 9 a.m., is a church cleanup day, which the more that show up, the quicker the work gets done. We need some organizing, branch cleaning up, and picked up and related jobs. By coincidence, I'm reading Deuteronomy and Romans at the same time. It struck me how the commandments and statutes that Moses gave the Israelites sounded so simple, yet there were so many, they would be impossible to keep them all. They covered every aspect of the Israelites' lives. Paul, however, gives the way to salvation in a simple matter-of-fact style that by faith you can be saved. So reading from Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, and Romans chapter 10, verses 4 to 13. Moses talking to the Israelites, Deuteronomy 10, 12 and 13. Now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require from you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways and love him, and to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the Lord's commandments and statutes, which I am commanding you today for your good. And then on to Romans 10, verses 4 to 13, Paul writes, "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes that the man who practices the righteousness which is based on law shall live by that righteousness. But the righteousness based on faith speaks as follows. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we are preaching. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. May God bless the reading of his word. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. As we begin this morning, let us pray. Father, we are incredibly blessed. That is such an understatement. When we think of all that you have done for us in Christ, when we think of just the laws that were placed upon Israel and that Christ has lived those laws perfectly, and that even though he was innocent, he died in our place. He set us free from the law. What a tremendous blessing we have. We thank you that through his sacrifice that we are brought together, that we are reconciled first and foremost to you, and we are reconciled with each other. What a tremendous, incredible blessing that we just are in awe that you would do something like that. You gave your very son to make that possible. We thank you for your word that teaches us, that instructs us, and we pray that this morning we would continue to learn from you, to be taught by you, that we would be eager to put these things into practice. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We are continuing in our study through the book of Romans. Last week we looked at how Christians are to handle disagreements with each other. Some Christians feel God's freedom and his liberty to enjoy the things of this world that are not strictly forbidden. So if Scripture doesn't forbid them, then we get to enjoy them. Other Christians don't feel those same freedoms, those same liberties. They feel compelled to a more strict understanding of Scripture. And in the course of this past week, as we're talking about disagreements, what disagreements did you encounter? You know, it might not have involved you. You might have only been a witness to a disagreement. But what disagreements did you encounter? It doesn't have to necessarily be a disagreement between Christians, but just disagreements between people. And as you think back on this last week, you probably had some disagreements, probably too many to count. Whether they were disagreements at home or disagreements at school or in the workplace, as you were running errands and you saw people in the store, we are involved in, or we are witness to, disagreements as a regular, everyday part of life. Some can be minor disagreements, just misunderstandings, and then other disagreements can result in severed relationships, and that separation in those relationships can last for decades. So if you didn't have enough disagreements, you can always get on social media. I'm sure you can find a disagreement or two right there. But that's what we see in the world. Frequent disagreements, chronic disputes, continual confrontations. Again, some of these disagreements are easily, quickly resolved, and others plant the seed of bitterness and resentment. Life in the church should be different than what we see in the world. Within the church, we have a community of believers that is focused on the kingdom of God, not on opinions. When disagreements do come up within the church, we should be seeking to do the most good for the other person. This is love for others, love of our neighbors. This morning we're going to finish up this section in the book of Romans. We looked at Romans chapter 14 last week that began this section. Paul in that chapter described two groups within the church. Within this church in Rome, there were those who were strong in the faith, and there were some who were weak in the faith. Paul grouped himself with those who were strong in the faith, and he mainly spoke to this group. Those who were strong in the faith, those are the ones who feel the liberty, the freedom to enjoy what Christ has done, and that they have these liberties in Christ. Those who are weak in the faith are those that just don't have that same sense of freedom. They feel more of a duty to live out maybe the Jewish celebrations. They live according to the Jewish dietary laws. That was what was going on in this church in Rome. Even though he sides with those who are strong in the faith, Paul never says, well, this group is right and this group is wrong. Paul instead says that the purpose is that all believers work together in unity. We must realize that Paul's not some idealist and he's just pretending that, well, there's no conflict ever in the church, there's no disagreements within the church. Paul's not that naive about things. But Paul's goal is to show how to preserve unity when conflict happens. Conflict will happen. Here's how to preserve unity when it happens. We are all sinners, and we are in different stages of our Christian maturity. Conflict is going to be unavoidable because we are all sinners. We've been saved by grace, but we are still sinners. That we are being sanctified and growing in Christ's likeness. And so when we have conflict, here's what to do when that happens. As we saw last week, the strong in the faith is to welcome the weak in the faith. So don't argue about the issues when divisions come. Don't use your liberty that you enjoy to weaken the faith of another believer. Or just because you don't feel the liberty, don't use your conviction to try to undermine the freedoms that another Christian enjoys. Whatever Christian convictions that you may have, live out those convictions without imposing your conviction on another Christian. The purpose of the church is to bring glory to Christ. And the church cannot glorify Christ when there are petty, insignificant issues that are dividing the local church body. As Paul wraps up this section, he's actually going to use Jesus as the example of what this looks like. How do you serve the weaker in faith? And so Paul is going to use Jesus as our example. Before we look at that, let's look at Paul's summary of his teaching on unity. This begins in Romans chapter 15. We're going to look at the first two verses. So Romans chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Paul writes, "We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up." So in these verses, Paul very clearly identifies as one who is strong in faith, meaning that he is a Christian who enjoys the liberties that Christ has given us. He enjoys those freedoms that Christ gives. And as one who is strong in faith, Paul is going to address others who are strong in faith when he says, "We have an obligation to those who are weak in faith." The obligation that we have is not to make them strong. It's not to teach them, "Hey, here's where you're wrong. You got to fix this." It's not to just make sure they get stronger in the faith, but it is to help them as they are weak in faith. Literally, it says to bear the weakness of those without strength. So what does it mean to bear the weakness of those without strength? Well, does this mean that you just grin and bear it and go, that's just who they are? Does it pretend everything's just fine? Or do we endure it? Do we just tolerate it, this person who is weak in their faith? Well, Paul's not talking about a passive, just look the other way, ignore it. Paul, the idea is that we come alongside to help someone. Instead of condemning them because you're just so weak in your faith, I'm just going to criticize you, but it's you help carry them along. The word for bear with is the same word that Jesus uses in Matthew 8:17, and in that verse, Matthew writes that Jesus fulfilled Isaiah's prophecies when the Messiah took our illnesses, he bore our weaknesses, he bare with our weaknesses or our diseases. And so would you want Jesus to simply put up with or to tolerate your diseases? Or would you want Jesus to do something about it? In these verses, Paul seems to be encouraging the strong to educate the weak on how to enjoy liberty. Don't be locked into this performance trap. This is how you have to live your faith. Paul's asked the strong to help the one who is weak. And so more than just letting somebody live in their ignorance of Christ's liberty, help them to understand the liberty that Christ has given us so that you can grow in your maturity, grow in your faith. And the way this happens, it's not forcing everybody to believe the way you believe. It's not condemning them because, you have weak faith. And it's not threats. The strong in faith are not to dominate the weak in faith. Instead, what we see is service, compassion, gentleness, living with understanding. This is Christian love for your brother and sister who is weaker in faith. You don't please yourself. You please your neighbor in order to build them up. You help them to understand that our righteousness doesn't come because of the things that we do or the things that we don't do. Our righteousness comes because of what Christ did already for us. Paul writes, let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. Well, does that mean that we are to be people pleasers? You know, I'm just going to ignore the things of God. I just want to make sure this person's happy to please my neighbor. When Paul writes this word neighbor, he's using it intentionally. He's referring back to Romans chapter 13. In Romans chapter 13, Paul talked about loving your neighbor. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. And you see this love that is poured out here with compassion, with gentleness, sincerity. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. So whether you are strong in the faith, enjoying liberty, or whether you are weak in faith and you're still working to understand Christian liberty, it's not about you. Whether you're strong or weak, it's not about you. It's about your brothers and your sisters in Christ. How can you best serve them for their benefit? In the world, we have enough beating people up. You know, if you don't agree with me, then I'm just going to prove you wrong. I'm going to humiliate you. I'm going to embarrass everything you stand for. That's what happens in the world. The world's full of that. The church should be a place of refuge. We may not see eye to eye on different issues, but we're always going to act with love. We're always going to act with appreciation for the other person. We will work together to worship Christ who saved us. And speaking of Christ, Jesus is our example. He shows us how to live this out. Paul mentions him, Romans 15 verses 3 and 4. So Romans 15 verses 3 and 4. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. In this world, the strong force their ways on the weak. That's the way the world works. Whoever's stronger forces their ways on the weak. They impose their will. With Christ, he is the strongest of the strong. He is God in human flesh. And yet at no point in his life on earth did he force his way on people. Not only did Jesus refrain from imposing his will, Jesus actually came to serve the weak. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul highlights the humility of Jesus. Here in Romans 15:3, Paul summarizes Jesus' life and his death on the cross with a quote from Psalm 69. The New Testament quotes Psalm 69 a few times. Most of the quotes from Psalm 69 are about Jesus dying on the cross. You might know this psalm as the psalm that prophesies about the Messiah who is going to drink sour wine as part of his suffering. That's this psalm, Psalm 69. It's a psalm that prophesies the rejection, the suffering of the Messiah. While Jesus could have come as a grand, majestic dictator, he didn't do that. Mark 10:45 says, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. By quoting Psalm 69, Paul focuses on the death of Jesus on the cross. Even though Jesus is the righteous one, he suffered by taking our sin on himself. He did this for us. He did this to serve the weak. Jesus had every right to command people, but instead he served people. Jesus is our example of how to care for the weaker Christian. we love and care for them in a way that it might even cause us to suffer. The weak do not suffer because of the strong. The strong serve the weak in ways that build up the weak so that their faith will increase. While Jesus modeled what this looks like, Jesus is far more than just a good example for us. The very thing that Paul wants to communicate by using this Old Testament reference is how Jesus died in our place. Because of our sin, we deserved the death that Jesus died. We deserved the punishment. We deserved the wrath of God. And yet, even as he was the one who was strong, Jesus died for the weak. He died for us. That's been Paul's point, is to describe what Jesus has done for us. The way we receive that substitution, Jesus dying for us, the way we receive that is by faith. We trust in the work of Christ, that he did everything we need in order to have our sin forgiven, in order to be in a reconciled relationship with God the Father. There's nothing that we can do that's going to add to his work. He did it all. He completed it. After he's quoting from the Old Testament scriptures, that's our Old Testament, the Hebrew scriptures, Paul says in verse 4 that these scriptures are for our good. The weak in faith, they're the Jewish Christians who are trying to follow the Old Testament, you know, still trying to have the Jewish celebrations, still trying to observe Jewish dietary laws. So the Old Testament kind of prescribed that for the life of the Jew, but the Old Testament's also pointing to the liberty that we have when the Messiah comes. The Messiah suffered for us. He gives us freedom. Jesus' death, his resurrection, did not remove the need for the Old Testament. The Old Testament is here still for our instruction. It's for our benefit. We have these words today to help us grow in our Christian faith. So how do we make it through the trials of life? How do we endure suffering? How do we know the character of God? How do we know how to live this life as the children of God? We know these things because God has given us his word. His word encourages us through dark days. It gives us endurance. So no matter what's going on in your life, and when you turn on the news and you see everything that's going on in the world, we have hope. We don't have fear. We have hope. Our hope comes because God has revealed himself through his word. He has revealed his plan, and everything will come to pass just as he has said. We read through the Old Testament and we see how Jesus fulfilled the scriptures. What a great testimony we have of knowing who God is, that he has a great plan for us. If you are not engaged in God's word, you're not going to find hope. You're not going to find encouragement to endure. Here at Bethel, we are a church that is committed to God's word. When we gather together, we're going to focus on what God has told us in his word. We're going to worship together as God has instructed us. As we worship together, as we study together, there is unity in the body of Christ. Look at how God's word brings unity, verses 5 and 6. Romans 15, verses 5 and 6. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul prays for this church in Rome. He asks that God would bless them with endurance and encouragement in order that they might live in harmony, not have divisions among them. When our collective focus is on God, we enjoy this harmony that Paul is talking about. When you think of all that Paul could have prayed for, I mean, there's so many things that Paul could have prayed for in this church in Rome. He could have prayed for them to have increased faith. He could have prayed for them to have perseverance. He could have prayed for them to have courage. I mean, they're right there in the heart of the Roman Empire. They are in Rome itself. He could have prayed for them to have joy in the midst of trial. He could have prayed for their protection, for their health. He could have prayed for long life. Instead of all of those things, Paul prays for harmony with one another. And he doesn't just pray at one time and just kind of an off, you know, I just pray that you have harmony. Paul prays the same idea using different words. He says harmony with one another, to be in accord with Christ Jesus, together with one voice, glorifying God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. This local church in Rome can answer the prayer that Paul just prayed for them. They can answer the prayer when they live out what Paul has instructed them to do. Verse 9, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you. It's for the glory of God. When Christ welcomed us, he didn't say, you know, I'll welcome you after you change a few things. When Christ welcomed us, he didn't say, I'll welcome you after you clean yourself up a little bit. He didn't say, well, you need to get some theological things right, and then you're welcome to come in. Christ welcomed us as we were. You know, our warts and all, we were sinners, we were unlovely, and yet Christ welcomed us. We are to follow his example as we welcome other believers in the local church. And this welcoming isn't because we want to be known as the friendliest church in town. We just want, oh, we need the reputation of being a friendly church. We don't welcome people just so that they think well of us. We welcome people for the glory of God. Everything we do in life is for the glory of God. Every interaction we have with people is an opportunity to glorify God in that interaction. That conversation that you have in the lobby after church, that conversation that you have over lunch, as you go into the workplace tomorrow, that conversation you have with a coworker, does that conversation show love for another person? Does it bring glory to God? This theme of unity shows us, it shows up throughout the New Testament. We see it so frequently in the New Testament because it was a focus that Jesus had for his disciples. The night that Jesus is about to be betrayed, he's out in the Garden of Gethsemane, he's praying, and he is praying this before his crucifixion. This is from John 17. So turn in your Bibles, John 17, verse 11. John 17, verse 11. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world. And I am coming to you, Holy Father. Keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. Skipping down a few verses from John 17. John 17, verses 20 through 23. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Jesus prays for unity in his disciples. He prays for unity in the church that will come after the disciples. That this unity that is in the church will be a witness to the world out there of the work of God. The world has disagreements. The world has arguments. In the church should be unity. The world has enough battles. But the church should be a place where believers gather together to glorify God. The theme of unity appears throughout the New Testament. It appears, if you look through Acts, it appears over and over again. We see in the letters of the New Testament, just these letters that are encouraging churches to be united. We see the Gentile churches that are collecting money to support the needs of the Jerusalem church. In fact, when you don't see unity in the early church, it's very noteworthy. I mean, it jumps out at the page because it is so anti the message of the New Testament. You might be thinking of two different examples, the same examples that I thought of, when there is not unity, there's disagreements. And the first one that jumps out at me is Paul and Barnabas. You know, Acts chapter 15, Paul and Barnabas have such a sharp disagreement that they part ways. The other disagreement that I thought of is the book of Galatians. In the book of Galatians, Paul says that he has to rebuke Peter publicly because Peter has some public sin issues. Peter's sin is keeping him from fellowshipping with Gentile believers. And so that's a public sin that Paul has to address with him. And in fact, This is one of the great miracles of God. God bringing together Jews and Gentiles. He brings them together in Christ. That's the whole point of Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11. And Paul's going to bring that up again here in Romans chapter 15. If God can bring together Jews and Gentiles, I mean, think about how different those groups are. If God can bring them together united in Christ, then God can certainly bring unity through whatever insignificant issues exist between Christians and a local church. So let's see what Paul writes here about the unity of Jews and Gentiles. Look at Romans 15, verses 8 through 13. Romans 15, verses 8 through 13. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised, that's to the Jews, to show God's truthfulness, in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name. And again it is said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. There's unity with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will come, even he who arises to rule the Gentiles. In him will the Gentiles hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. These verses really summarize the book of Romans. You know, we read about Jesus who came. He fulfilled the promises of God. These promises were given to the Jewish people, and they wrote them down, and we see Jesus fulfilling them because he is the Messiah, the promised Messiah. And as Jesus comes, he fulfills the Jewish scripture. He brings the Gentiles into relationship with the Jewish people as the people of God. And together, Jews and Gentiles glorify God. This is a very basic summary of this incredibly deep and incredibly theologically rich letter that we have to the Romans. But in these verses, Paul's emphasizing God has fulfilled his plan. He did this through Jesus, who came as the Messiah, the promised Messiah. God gave his word to the people of Israel. They recorded these words. God's word contained prophecies to reveal, to know who the Messiah was, and who would come to save a people for himself, that he would save them from their sin. The people are saved. It's not just the Jews only. You know, the Jews had the prophecies. They wrote the prophecies. Jesus came through the Jewish people, but Jesus doesn't save just Jewish people. Jesus saves Gentiles also. Those who were far off have been brought near. That's what Ephesians 2:13 says. This amazing work of Christ unifies all those who have faith in him. So no matter what your background is, no matter what sin issues you have, no matter what you've faced in the past, no matter what disagreements you have, the work of Christ saves all who respond in faith. And the work of Christ brings us together in unity. And if Christ can bring together two groups as diametrically opposed to each other as Jews and Gentiles, Christ can bring together anyone in the local church. We must keep our eyes on him, follow his example of welcoming all believers just as he welcomed us. And then verse 13 is just a great benediction to wrap all of this up. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. As we look at these verses, maybe you realize, you know what, I've been thinking of myself too much. You know, these disagreements that seem to come up, you know, I have my part to play. I need to apologize for those things. I need to repent of those things. Maybe you've been insisting too much on your way, or you're not demonstrating as much love as you really need to care for your neighbor. Maybe you're not welcoming people with different opinions and welcoming them in the name of Christ. Christ brings reconciliation. He's able to forgive. Christ is able to bring unity. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, just as Paul says, we may abound in hope. Not just a little hope, but we may abound in hope. Let's come together as we worship in closing prayer. Father, we look around and we see so many conflicts in the world. And we know that, unfortunately, conflict even exists within the churches. I thank you for peace and unity and harmony that comes in knowing Christ. That Christ has first and foremost reconciled us with you. And I thank you that he has reconciled us with each other. That in Christ we are together as brothers and sisters in Christ, worshiping you, bringing glory to you. I pray that if there's any conflicts that we have, that we might repent of those. We might seek forgiveness from those that we might have hurt. And I pray, God, that you would be the unifier, the great unifier. We can rejoice at how you have brought reconciliation. Thank you for your tremendous word. Thank you for your tremendous work. And it's in the name of Christ we pray all of these things. Amen. Would you please stand as we sing together?
Creation, all of the earth, for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Yes, Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for the groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so, come, oh Jesus, come. Even so, come, oh Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Oh, like a bride waiting for her room, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. God, we wait your coming soon. So we wait for you. God, we wait your coming soon. Like a bride.
Thank you all for being with us this morning. Just a reminder that you can give tithes and offerings as part of our worship. If you're here present in this building, then you can give in the giving box at the back, or you can give online at bethelsi.org. If you're watching and want to know more about Christ, go to our website. There's a little button that says Ask for Prayer. Just fill that in. Let us know if you have questions or anything about Christ, how you can follow him. Just let us know. We'll be happy to follow up with you. If you're here in person and want to know more about following Christ and the reconciliation that he brings between us and God, then you can find me, one of our elders or deacons after church. We'd be happy to share with you more about that. Just a reminder for kids, we do have our children's church after our children's Sunday school right after service. You can meet by the stairs, and then Miss Kim will take you downstairs for class for about 30 minutes. Let's bow for a benediction this morning. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen.